you are about to see is true. The names have been changed to protect the innocent.
This is the city. Los Angeles, California. I work here. I'm a cop. It was Monday, January 25th. It was warm in Los Angeles. We were working the day watch out of robbery division. My partner's Frank Smith. The boss is Captain Donahoe. My name's Friday. I'd just gotten back from lunch, and it looked like it was going to be another quiet afternoon. How was your lunch?
Okay.
You know, I'd eat with you, but I just can't eat hot dogs 5 days in a row.
Well, we don't have to do it anymore.
Hmm?
I got the sign.
You did, huh?
Yeah. I've been eating at the Penny Arcade because I knew Ernie was going to take out his dart game. Today, he took the sign down.
Yeah, that's very nice.
I gave him a buck for it. How do you like it?
That's very good. What are you going to do, put in a dart game?
No, it's for my kid.
Well, he's going to put in the dart game.
No, Joe. He sells lemonade. He's going to add tarts.
Oh, I see.
You think I can make this D into a T?
Yeah. Yeah, I think so. Just cross it over there on the top and paint out that bottom part.
Yeah.
That's very nice. When's he sell this stuff?
Saturday and Sunday.
Fay, I suppose, makes all the stuff for him, doesn't she?
No, he makes it all himself.
Well, how old's your boy?
5 and a half.
Well, if I'm over in the neighborhood Sunday, I'll drop by and buy some stuff from him, huh?
Good. He'll like that. And Joe?
Hmm?
Just buy the lemonade. He makes that real good.
Why, what do you mean?
He makes the tarts out of mud.
Hot one.
ADT 211.
Bank robbery in progress. It took us a little over 4 minutes to get to the bank at the corner of Lebanon and Broadway. In that time, the bandit had completed the robbery and made good his escape. A radio car had arrived at the scene, and the officers had gotten a description of the car and of the bandit. They'd called the information into communications, and a broadcast was gotten out to all cars in the vicinity to be on the alert for the holdup man.
I couldn't help it. What did you want me to do? If I tried to stop him and he'd shot that gun off, he'd have killed half the people in here.
I'm not saying you should have actually tried to stop him. I'm only saying there must have been something you could have done. You just stood there and looked at him. There must have been something.
I beg your pardon, sir.
Well, Gibson, don't just stand there. Stop these men.
We're police officers.
You see, Gibson, they're police officers. Have you a badge or something?
Yes, sir. Here's my identification.
Oh, yes, Mr. Friday.
That's right. This is my partner, Frank Smith.
I saw that on his card. You'd like to ask me a lot of questions?
Yes, sir, we would.
You'd like to talk in my office, I guess?
That'll be fine.
Would you mind if Gibson came along? I'd like to have him see how a couple of real detectives work.
Yes, sir, that'll be all right.
Fine, right in here. Oh, Mr. Friday, this is Gibson, my bank guard, and I use the term loosely.
Gibson?
This is Mr. Jones.
Smith.
Smith. Gibson, Smith. Just sit down anywhere.
Thank you.
Oh, thank you.
You stand up. And listen.
Yes, sir.
What is your name, sir?
Clifford Allen. I'm the bank manager.
And what's your first name?
Leon Gibson.
Understand you're a bank guard?
Oh, of course he's not. Not officially. He's a little idea of mine. Undercover. He's not a real bank guard.
All right, sir, if you'd like to tell us what happened here.
It was just 3 o'clock. Gibson was putting up the chain across the door, you know, to keep the people out.
Yes, sir.
Gibson was out there. I was in here in my office. Well, go ahead. Tell the officers about it.
Yes, sir. Well, he parked his car right in front of the bank. When he pulled up, I thought it was a customer trying to get in before the bank closed. I held the chain for him.
That was nice of you.
What happened then, Gibson?
As soon as he got to the doorway, I saw the shotgun. Had it kind of under his coat. I tried to stop him, but he had the gun pointed right at me. He said that if I made a move, he'd as soon shoot as look at me.
Uh-huh. Now, you're sure it was a shotgun?
Yeah. It was a 12-gauge. Sawed off. He told me to get over into the little alcove near the entrance to our escrow department. I did, and he told me to hand over my gun.
Did you?
No, sir. Mr. Allen won't let me carry one.
Uh-huh.
I did what he told me.
What happened then?
He asked me where the manager was. He pointed out his office.
Well, now, up to this time, did any of the people in the bank have any idea what was going on?
No, sir. The way the holdup man acted, he knew what he was doing. There wasn't anything I could do. I kept thinking about the people in the bank. That shotgun. Didn't want anyone to get hurt.
Only bright thing he did.
All right, would you like to go on? What happened then?
Like I said, he asked where the manager's office was. And I showed him. And he told me that he wanted me to come back here with him.
Uh-huh.
He put the shotgun under his coat. Nobody in the bank saw it.
And that's where I came into it. He just walked in, told me it was a stick-up. He had this little leather bag, kind of like a doctor uses. He opened it up and told me to walk out in front of him.
Yes, sir.
Made me carry the bag. Kept the gun at my back all the time. I could feel it. Made me walk down the row of windows, the ones into the teller's boxes.
Did he touch anything at all, did you notice?
No, sir. He wore gloves all the time. At each window, he said for the teller to be quiet. After I got the money from the tellers and put it into the bag, he told them that if they made a sound, he'd kill me. And then come back and kill them, too. Oh, it was terrible. Almost scared me to death.
Yes, sir. Who was it that turned in the alarm?
Walter, the cleanup man. He was in the back of the bank. And he came out of the vice president's office and saw the robber. Then he sneaked back into the room and called you. Bandit just barely got out of the place when the police car pulled up.
We gave the other officers a description of the car and the bandit.
Yeah, we heard the broadcast. All the cars in the area have been alerted.
I wonder if I could have a drink of water, officer. I'm so nervous. My stomach's going to be grinding for a month.
Surely. You're a member of the Federal Reserve, aren't you?
Oh, yes.
Mm-hmm.
That means the Federal Bureau of Investigation will be brought into it, too.
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. Fresh water, Gibson?
You bet.
Ulcers.
Yes, sir.
Would you gentlemen like some?
No, no, thanks.
No, sir. I would, Mr. Allen.
You buy your own pills. Tell me, Gibson, just what have you done in the 5 months you've been with us?
Well, sir, I won all those bowling trophies.
You can't cash those at window three.
What happened after the man finished taking all the money from the cages?
He walked out of the front of the place and got his car.
By that time, I could hear the sirens of the police car coming.
Did he say anything when he went out?
Yeah. Said that if we told anything about him, he'd come back and kill us.
Yeah, and he looked right at me when he said it. You've got to give me some sort of protection. I'm not going to make a sitting duck of myself.
Yes, sir, we'll take care of that.
Could you give us a description of the man?
I've already given it to the other officers.
We know, sir. We'd like to have it again. How tall would you say he was?
Oh, about 5'11", maybe 6".
How about his age?
30, 35, round in there.
Mm-hmm. How much you think he weighed?
Well, about 160 pounds, maybe more. I'm not very good at guessing weights.
Was he dark or light-complected?
Oh, light. He had real light blonde hair. His eyebrows were almost invisible. They were so light that you almost couldn't see them at all. Same with his eyelashes.
I see. Now, how about his clothes?
I beg your pardon?
His clothes. What was he wearing?
He had on a blue shirt.
I'm sorry, sir, but I think it was a white shirt.
Was it? No, I'm sure it was blue. I remember because he was wearing a brown coat. And I thought that he certainly didn't have very good taste, what with wearing a blue shirt and a brown coat. No, Gibson, the shirt was blue. No tie. The brown coat and black loafer shoes. I remember those because they were the only thing that looked good. They looked like those ones that are advertised in magazines. You know, Skeegans or something like that. Black.
Yes, sir.
Had those little tassel things on them.
Anything else about him?
What?
Well, anything else that might cause you to remember him, to know him if you saw him again.
Well, there were the bandages.
What?
When he came in, he had bandages on his face. One over his right eyebrow, another one on his chin, right here, sort of on the throat, kind of.
You mean regular bandages?
No, they were those adhesive kind. You know, with the gauze and the tape all together.
Oh, I see.
I still think it was a white shirt.
Blue. Are you trying to say that I don't know blue when I see it?
No, sir. I just think that you might have made a mistake.
Mr. Friday.
Yes, sir.
It was a blue shirt.
How about his car? Where was it?
It was parked right out in front.
Did you see it?
Certainly, I saw it. I was standing right in the door when he drove away.
What if you could describe it for us?
Yes, like I told the other officers. It was a late model Buick, dark blue, a coupe.
I'm sorry, sir, but it was a green Ford sedan.
I don't know what you're trying to prove with these officers. After the way you handled the affair, there's no use you trying to impress them with your prowess as a detective. It was a dark blue Buick coupe.
Anything unusual about the car that you could see? Any dented fenders, stickers, windshield emblems, anything at all like that?
No, I didn't notice anything special.
No, sir. Looked pretty new, as far as I could tell.
All right, fine. Well, you two gentlemen have helped us a lot. We'd like to talk to some other people here in the bank if we could.
Yes, that's what the other officer said. I told all the help to stay.
Yes, sir.
Fine. You want to talk to them in here? Feel free to use the office.
No, sir, that's all right. We can see them outside. I'm going to leave you one of our cards, Mr. Allen. If you think of anything else, let us know, will you?
Fine. I'll be here.
Thank you.
Wonder if I could have a card, too.
You don't need one.
Officers.
Would you mind stepping over here?
okay?
No, I think we'd better move over here.
How's this?
No. Yes, this will be fine.
All right, what's on your mind?
I didn't want to tell you while we were in there. He'd probably make some remark.
Yeah.
I didn't tell the other officers either. It's about the license number of the bandit's car.
Did you get it?
Not all of it, sir. Just the first three numbers.
I see.
I didn't tell the other officers this. I saved it for you. You're detectives.
Okay.
Also, the bandit had a piece of cloth wrapped around the license plate. As he drove away, the wind blew the cloth aside. I saw three numbers.
Good.
May I give this to him?
Sure.
I hope I did good, officers.
You did fine. Thanks, Gibson.
One of your cards.
Company of FBI agent Tom Ashford, we talked to the rest of the employees in the bank. From them, we got a fairly good description of the holdup man and his car. They agreed that it was a late model, dark-colored Ford sedan. Frank and I went back to the office and made arrangements for another team of detectives to help us in checking out the information we had. At 9:46 that night, Frank and I went to our DMV while agent Tom Ashford checked the records of the Department of Motor Vehicles downtown. It took us 8 hours to go through the possible 10,000 numbers. Each card had to be checked for similarity of car make and model. Each car in the immediate area was listed. Then each car in the entire state. Each of them had to be checked out.
Hi, how'd you do?
Big job. There's the list.
Huh. Half of them are typewritten. Girl had to go home. I wrote the rest out myself.
Yeah. Big list. Yeah, I never knew there were so many cars in California, let alone that many in the Los Angeles area with license 1U5.
Fine. How's luck, Joe? What's the total?
Well, I tell you, we got a place to start.
Yeah?
302 names.
At 9 a.m., Frank and I met in the robbery office. We talked to Lieutenant Stoner, and he assigned four other teams of men to work with us. The FBI had also assigned additional agents. The list of possibles was divided up, and we began to check them out. We spent 3 days on it. In each instance, we didn't talk to the person involved directly, but to their neighbors. We didn't explain what it was that we were after, merely that we were conducting an investigation. We ran into the usual false leads, the usual petty jealousies, and the neighborhood feuds. It all served to slow us down and make the job more difficult. There had been no replies to the local or the APB that we'd gotten out on the car or the bandit. The stats office had come up with two possibles on the MO. These were both checked out, but they led us nowhere. We went back to checking out the license plate numbers. February 8th. The names on the list were down to seven. The next one was a Mr. Ivan Q. Field. We rang the bell to the house next door.
Yes?
Sorry to bother you, ma'am. Police officers. Wonder if we could talk to you.
Police? What's this about? I haven't done anything.
No, ma'am, not you. We'd like to ask you some questions about your next-door neighbor, Mr. Field.
I should have known. A couple of times I came close to calling in about him myself. Miserable man.
Wonder if we could come inside. Be a little better than talking out here?
Well, you just bet you can. Come right on in. I'll tell you what you want to know. No. That chair goes over there.
I beg your pardon?
Let's move the furniture around. It's better for talking. I want this settee over here. You two boys can do that.
Yes, ma'am.
Well, get busy, young man. No. You sit here.
Yes, ma'am.
Uh-uh. That's your chair. That one's for him.
Thank you.
Well, pull your chair around. You can join us. There now. Isn't this better?
Yes, ma'am.
Now, what do you want to know?
What's your name, ma'am?
Mabel Hartford.
All right, Miss Hartford. We're conducting an investigation. There are a few things we'd like to know about Mr. Field.
Uh-huh. Well, you don't have to play cozy with me. I know what kind of people they are. Can't understand it either.
What do you mean, ma'am?
I said I couldn't understand it. His brother's so nice, real gentleman. Seems hard to believe they'd even be related, let alone be brothers. Nothing but trouble ever since him and his wife moved in.
You mean it's not their house?
Of course not. I don't think either one of them could afford the rent on a one-room apartment, much less that house.
Would you know if they have a car?
No, not them. Like I said, I don't think he's ever worked. Just lives off his brother. His brother has a car. Real nice.
What kind of a car is it, ma'am? Do you know?
Yes, it's a Ford.
Do you know what model?
Model?
Yes, ma'am. Is it a coupe or a sedan?
It's a sedan. Real nice. Sort of dark green. Well, I guess it really isn't dark, but then it really isn't light. Just green. Pretty, though.
Yes, ma'am. Do you know if Mr. Field is home right now?
Well, yes, I think so. I saw him out in the backyard a couple hours ago. Him and his wife, she was tiptoeing around in one of them skimpy little sunsuits. Terrible. No decency at all. I tell you, officer, neither one of them's any good.
Yes, ma'am.
Well, let's smoke it up.
I got some here, too.
Thank you.
Is a light?
Thanks.
Oh, thank you. Right? Miss Hartford, I wonder if you can tell us what Mr. Field does for a living.
You mean, does he work?
That's right.
No. At least I've never seen any indication that he does. All he does is just sit around the yard and throw rocks at my cats. Terrible. That's what I was going to call you about, officer. Isn't there a law or something about throwing things at poor, dumb animals?
Yes, ma'am, there is.
Of course, cats aren't really dumb. Lots of times I think they're a lot smarter than some people I know.
Could you describe Ivan Field?
Sure. He's kind of a little man, not very tall.
About how tall, ma'am?
Well, maybe 5'7".
Uh-huh. What about his coloring?
You mean his hair?
Yes, ma'am.
Dark, very dark.
Well, that's us out.
Yeah, it looks that way, doesn't it?
Well, thank you very much, ma'am. Sorry to cause you any trouble.
There's no trouble at all. You gonna arrest him now?
No, ma'am.
Well, why not? What about the rocks and my cats?
Well, I think the SPCA are the people you want to talk to.
Well, all right, but I'll tell you right now, Mr. Field isn't going to like it. He likes my cats. He isn't going to like the idea at all when he hears about it. Just wait till he gets home. I'll tell him about how his brother's been acting.
Just a minute, ma'am.
Yes?
You mean that the man living next door now isn't Ivan Field?
No, I didn't say it was. It's his brother, Anthony.
His brother?
What's going on here? First you ask a lot of questions about Mr. Field, and then I tell you that he isn't home. He and his wife went back east for the holidays. They haven't come back yet. While he was gone, he said that his brother could use the house. I thought at first it'd be nice, but then I found out. Anthony's nothing like his brother. Nothing at all.
Well, what does this Anthony Field look like?
My, you want to know about everybody, don't you?
Well, I would sure like a description of Anthony Field, that's all.
Well, he's taller than Ivan. Anthony must be close to 6 feet, and he doesn't look anything like Ivan. Ivan's dark, Anthony's light. His hair almost doesn't have any color. Real blonde.
How long ago did they move in?
Let's see. Elizabeth, that's my Persian.
Uh-huh.
Elizabeth had her last litter in December, December the 12th. Anthony and his wife moved in the next morning. I remember that because I was up most of the night with Elizabeth. She didn't need me, awfully independent. But it was the morning they moved in. I remember it well. Elizabeth had 6 little kittens. It was December the 13th when Anthony moved in.
I see. Have they been using Ivan Field's car?
Oh, my, yes. Hardly a day goes by but what they don't drive it somewhere.
Wonder if we could use your phone, ma'am.
Phone. Now, don't tell me anybody. Yes, it's right there on the table in the hall.
Thank you. I'll check the name through R&I.
Right. Could you tell us whether this Anthony Field has any marks or scars?
Now, let me see. I think so. Seems that I saw him and his wife out in the backyard one day. He was wearing swimming trunks, and she was in one of those sunsuits I told you about. Disgraceful.
Yes, ma'am.
Well, it seems to me that he had a scar on his leg. Yes, just above the knee. I think it was the right leg.
No, ma'am. What I meant was, does he have any marks or scars on his face? Like on his forehead or on his chin, maybe?
Oh, no. No marks.
Oh.
Wait a minute. The other day, I noticed he had a cut right over his right eyebrow. Looked like he'd been in a fight. Probably a drunken brawl.
Joe, anything?
Yeah.
Well, thank you very much, Miss Hartford. You've been a great help. We'll be checking back with you.
Fine. Good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Well, where are you going?
I beg your pardon.
We've got to put the furniture back. I won't be having any company for a whole week.
Yes, ma'am.
A little more to the left, don't you remember?
Surely.
That's good. My, you have a good memory.
Good night, ma'am.
Good night. There now. Isn't this better?
How about it?
I talked to Swan. No record on Ivan Field.
Yeah.
They paroled an Anthony Field from Q.
How about the description?
Checks out.
When did they parole him?
December 10th, last year.
Yeah.
Did a term for robbery.
Tuesday, February 8th. To utilize whatever evidence we might find in the house for the government's prosecution of the case, a search warrant was obtained to allow Agent Tom Ashford to enter the house. The men from robbery arrived, and the plan for taking Field was formulated. Because of Field's description, his past record, and the fact that the car he drove matched the one used in the holdup, he had become our prime suspect. The working detective knows that to successfully apprehend an armed and potentially dangerous suspect, he must act quickly and employ the one big advantage on his side, the element of surprise. By moving rapidly before the suspect becomes aware of any act to apprehend him, the officer in many cases can not only avoid bloodshed, but can have a better chance of preserving any and all physical evidence necessary to prosecute. 8:14 p.m. We were ready to move in.
All set, Joe.
Good. The lights are still on. There's no indication he knows we're here.
Let's hope it stays that way.
Yeah. Officer! Mr. Friday!
Oh, that'll be a help.
Officer!
Keep your voice down. We don't want Field to know we're here.
I'm not talking loud. There's something I want to tell you.
All right, please. Will you go back in your house and stay there till this is over?
Well, that's sort of what I want to tell you.
What's that?
Well, I got to thinking. I figured maybe Anthony wasn't such a bad sort after all.
All right, fine, Ms. Hartford. Now, I don't mean to be rude, but get back in your house and stay there. We keep making all this noise. He's going to know we're here.
Well, that's just it. I don't want anybody to get hurt, so I called him.
You what?
I called him and told him he didn't have a chance. He should give himself up.
Unknowingly, Mrs. Hartford had made it impossible to take the suspect without violence. By warning him, she'd put him on the alert. We had no alternative now but to apprehend him as best we could. All right, come on, your feet. Hands behind your head.
What are you trying to do?
Come on, you've been this way before. Move. Get it up there.
He's clean, Joe.
You gonna tell us about it?
It's my money. I can do what I want with it.
You keep believing that. We got the money and the people who can identify you. Car parked in the driveway fits the description. You got out of queue on December 10th. You pulled this job January 25th. We got you made right down the line.
I fell once. I did my time. You got nothing more.
Yeah, sure.
This is wife. Found her hiding in the back bedroom. Looks like the shotgun he used. Sit down, lady.
You guys are fishing. You got nothing.
Yeah.
Those witnesses could be wrong, you know.
Wait till you hear them.
February 19th, trial was held in United States District Court, State of California. In a moment, the results of that trial. The suspect was tried and convicted of violation of the federal bank robbery statute and was sentenced to 20 years in a federal penitentiary. Further investigation showed that the suspect's wife, Dora Nancy Field, was not implicated in any way in the robbery of the bank. No charges were made against her.